Welcome back to The Edge of Casual. I am Verso, and I will just admit that I am a bit obsessed with Software Inc. at the moment. It's a simple game, but there's enough depth under the hood that it has triggered some sort of craving, I guess, within me to better understand the way that all the systems work together. So within this video, I'm going to focus upon employees because I feel as though there are a few matters that I probably would have liked to have known when I began, and ultimately I'm doing this because I'm a huge nerd and I love talking about video games, whether anybody is listening or not. So, without further ado, you will always start the game with one employee, your founder, right? So don't get used to how efficient this guy is. He draws no salary, he receives no benefits, doesn't need to sleep, probably doesn't even need to eat. He's a superhuman who spares you from having to deal with the ins and outs of employee management in the early years. But being honest, this is a tycoon game. Most of us are going to be champing at the bit to hire our first employees so that we can feel like big shot software bosses. And the thing is, though, that and this is just a personal feeling, but I don't think that you should ever even look at the employee hiring system until you have a very specific need for somebody. And I don't mean, you know, I want to code a video game, so I need some developers. I mean, like, this guy can make me money tomorrow if I hire him today. So, employees are hands down the largest expense that you will see, so you don't want to go acquiring new people willy-nilly. And by the way, employees will attempt to renegotiate their salaries every December, and they almost always ask for outlandish raises, sometimes in the area of 100% pay increases. You don't have to accede to these demands. The largest raise I ever give anybody is $150. If they file a complaint with HR, you can cave if you want to, but here's a funny thing. You can just come back to them a few months later once they've calmed down a little bit, and you can usually cut their salary again. And quick note, by the way, I've been playing exclusively at the impossible difficulty setting, where you really have to thread the needle sometimes, or at least I think so. But at lower difficulties, even medium, you probably don't have to sweat these sorts of things too much. Anyway, my first employees probably aren't even going to be doing work on my own IP, so at a bare minimum, I wait about a year and a half to get to the point where some decent deals start coming in through my reception desk. Also, just a personal preference, because I know a lot of people like to work out of the starting garage for years while they toil away on their first antivirus software or whatever it is. But I only really like to start hiring people once I begin building my own custom HQ. Even if all I've gotten is an office, a bathroom, and a picnic table, I just like the flexibility you get from the building system to divide up your employees however you like or build utility rooms, that sort of thing. Once you do start hiring, however, most people will say that you should never hire the low-level employees, and I have to say I sort of agree. The problem is that employees largely gain skill through use, and the problem with hiring employees that can't do anything is that they therefore cannot get better at doing anything. So because instead of being like, oh, can I look over your shoulder, look at your code, learn from a book, etc., they'll just be like, can't do it, so I'll just sit here and twiddle my thumbs, and they won't get it better. So, I mean, I have my issues with that, but it is what it is. All that said, I actually hire low-level employees all the time, and it slows things down significantly, but like most things in this game, it's your choice. And what I like about low-level employees is that you can basically pay them peanuts, and you get to spec them out to your liking instead of whatever weird combination of skills you might get from more mid-range hires. But, you know, expect to wait about 5 years before they're worth anything at all. So the game doesn't punish you really, except maybe in some subtle ways for taking the slow boat, but you know, if that's what you prefer, you can do that. I will say it's a pretty stupid way to play, and it's just my own idiosyncratic style. So beyond that, avoid hiring employees with bad personality traits like short-tempered or pessimistic. I like to hire extroverts personally, even though in real life I'm an introvert. People with flirty or generous personalities are also good. Other YouTubers probably have run the numbers on the productivity bonuses that this can get you, but I don't really min-max to that level. I simply try to follow a common sense approach, and it works out fine. I'm honestly not sure about traits like naive or cocky, but you know, just exercise your own judgment on that. I typically only try to hire employees that have great compatibility with the team with which they'll be working. So for that matter, I try to really be consistent across the board, because I might want to move employees around from team to team later. So for example, you might have a team of introverts that get along fantastically, and another team of extroverts that all love each other, but maybe you'll want to redistribute skills at some point, and none of these guys are going to mix well together. So the major gotcha, though, that I found with hiring is that you have to be particularly mindful of where the pip sits on the Likert scale between lazy and stressed. Because I will tell you now, if you ever have to fire an employee, it will probably be because he's so stressed in his role that he just stops working entirely. You know, no work, and just sits there, you know, idle all day. And essentially, if it's even one spot to the right of the center on the scale, they will at some point basically have a nervous breakdown at work if you consistently assign them to or their team to more than one task. It's just not worth it. I hope that gets rebalanced, but it is how it is right now. All of these scales are worth thinking about, by the way, because they do have an effect on gameplay. So, for example, a very fast learner can be picking up new skills literally twice as fast as somebody who is purely just a hard worker, like all the way to the left on that scale. In fact, I just saw somebody run a test on that this morning, so that's why I know that. I consider hiring to be pretty important, honestly, and I don't think you should do it unless you have cash to burn because you might need to run through your searches a few times, though you can be a little more fast and loose with it if you're only hiring temps, which is to say, like, employees that you will probably fire once you're done with them, like once they finish whatever job you need them to do. And then maybe you don't care too much about the quality of their work either. For example, early on, I like to generate income by doing design deals for other companies. So you can easily hire as many people as you need to do the job for as long as it lasts and pocket the difference between what the deal pays to you and what you pay to your temps. As to ideal team composition, I'm really not the sort of person who would ever tell you how to min-max that. I've tried all kinds of things, and ideally you probably want to be building teams around the requirements for the sorts of software products you intend to be releasing, but really I find this to be such a personal decision. Right now, for example, I'm just toying around with two-person teams where each person does design, programming, and art. And is that smart? No, probably not, not at all, but it's how I've been doing it. Don't forget that employees get sick and take vacations, so it's really not worth it to run the absolute tightest ship possible. It is good to have some slack. You don't need to pay employees what they ask either, particularly fresh hires. If, for example, you decide you want to pay all first-year level designers $3,000, you usually can get away with that either, you know, before they show up for their first day or sometime soon thereafter. If it's a pay cut, it upsets them slightly, but they get over it within a few days. Ironically, it seems like they get far more annoyed when they don't get the raises that they request, and that's why it's best to decide early on what employees are worth and make sure that they start at that level. And you can use whatever rubric you like. The default setting for teams is an 8-hour workday, which, I don't know, it seems a little bit short to me, especially since it isn't as though your employees are skipping lunch or anything like that. I will usually bump it out to a 9-hour day. Maybe you could go further with it if you wanted to be a jerk about it, but they do get pretty exhausted by the end of the day. Also, default for vacations is only 2 months of the year, July through August, which means that everybody basically leaves at the same time of the year. And I always set this to 12 months, even though it makes things less predictable, but for me, I don't like the situation where your entire staff goes away for the summer. That's probably because I'm American and not from some more enlightened country. Okay, this one is just my opinion. Some people take issue with it, probably a lot of people, but you don't really need team leads. Team leads are great because they can hold meetings, which temporarily buff employee satisfaction and effectiveness, as well as conveying passive across-the-board skill gains. Additionally, you can use them to manage HR tasks for you, automation, and so forth. But if you don't mind the micromanagement, I really don't think that they're all that necessary. The problem I see with them is that they, A, demand high salaries, and B, they don't get a whole lot accomplished besides their leadership tasks. The second one is a bit subjective, maybe. I've never measured it, but even when trained in multitasking, it really just feels like leaders are at best like half employees if you want to use them for development work. I mean, when you've got critical mass as a company, you'll want to have leaders, of course, but you can certainly get away without them for a good long while, I guess is all I'm saying. So if you do use a team leader, I mean, it's sort of up to you how you want to spec them. I like to spec them 3 stars in socialization and multitasking to get the benefits to employee happiness and productivity, and I think it's just a playstyle choice on your part. Beyond that, night shifts. I see a lot of people maximizing their facilities by running day and night shifts. I don't do it personally because I don't like to work at night and I feel bad about doing it to my employees in the game, and they don't like it. You can get away with it though by going into the employee benefits system and giving them bonus pay for evening hours. Okay, so these are all beginner tips, and I know that I've been going on about this for way too long, so feel free to weigh in with your own advice below. Keeping in mind that my philosophy is that there's no wrong way to play games. Casual is, after all, in the channel name. That said, I've been Verso, and thanks for coming out to the Edge of Casual with me.